This is your boy, J.A., and welcome to Creative Conversations with J.A. We just have a conversation about things that affect your world. This is our 28th show. Can you believe it? Show 28. We started in February, and here we are at our 28th show. I'm excited about our guests. Today, my brother is here, Brother Sam Roberts, or Sama Sam Roberts, Choir Master Sam Roberts, whatever you want to call him. But he's in the house. He's in the studio, locked and loaded. And before I bring him in, follow us on all our social medias, Creative Conversations with J.A., Facebook, Creative Conversations with J.A., Instagram, Creative Conversations with J.A., YouTube, which is broadcasting live right now. Not only are we on social media, we got a couple platforms going on. We're on Spotify, we're on iHeart, we're on Amazon Music, we're on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, a couple others we're on. We're excited to be on those. So our topic this month has been how important is music ministry in the church? How important is music ministry in the church? And if you have seen the dialogue lately, I don't know, God had dropped it in my spirit. You know, I'm a little churchy. God had dropped it in my spirit to do that, you know, topic. And look where we at. There's a lot of controversy about music. But we just want to set the record straight about music. We had my sister Sama, Shoshonda Ward, came in and she said, you don't need to set the atmosphere. Stop putting so much pressure on yourself. You can't set the atmosphere. All you need to do is worship. And I said, wait a minute, I don't need to cheerlead. She said, all you need to do is worship and God will do the rest. So that took me for a loop. I said, I thought we were supposed to set the atmosphere. She said, God sets the atmosphere. And then we had Nikki Thorpe coming last week and hit us with a couple good nuggets. One of my mentors from Northside Institutional, Kojic, came in and she said the relationship between the pastor and the minister of music is so important. It's their house. It's not your house. So it's their house and not your house. And so today I have my brother Sam Roberts. Of Sam Roberts and Levites Assembly Squaw with the Cause. Here, I met Sam through my brother, Travis Malloy, and I feel like I'm getting old. We've been friends for a long time, and my brother, I'm just excited. You know, he's one of the, you know, premier choir directors, so he's all over. And I'm ready to have this conversation with my brother. So I'm just going to bring him in. Brother.
What's up, brother?
How are you doing?
I'm good, man. I got a hard act to follow, man. Whoa.
I know. They brought it, but they say every round goes higher and higher. So I'm excited about this conversation today. So before bring in the conversation, I want you to just introduce yourself. Tell them who you are, what you do. I mean, I don't know why they don't know you, but
I ain't nobody, man. I'm Sam Roberts. I have a choir called the Levites Assembly, or LA as people call us. And we just, you know, a choir, make some good music. Y'all probably know some of my music from my brother Charles Butler. The song Make It is a song that I wrote and he recorded, and that went, you know, on radio and all of that great stuff. And so I have my own music though, praise God. And so, you know, We got some, just look us up, Sam Robertson, LA. This ain't about me today. Let's go.
Let's go. So my topic was, and I don't know what, how I came up with it, how important is music in church? How important is the music ministry in church? You know, some pastors think, oh, it's just the appetizer. Some pastors don't think it's important. They stay in the office and don't have to preach. But how important is minister music, the ministry of music, brother?
Well, you know, I think that preaching and music ministry are like the perfect marriage. You know what I'm saying? When you have a great music ministry and a great word, and they're on the same page, that's unstoppable ministry. And I've had the pleasure of being at some, in some churches where we did have that. And it was just amazing to see what God did. And I've also been in some churches where it was like, you're hired to do your job. And I'm here to preach, you know, and it was kind of separate. You know, we tried to do our thing in the music ministry and they tried to preach well, but it wasn't as good as like when the two on one page, like that thing is crazy. Like, and I don't think that either one is like more important than the other. I think that they're both made to complement each other. And so I love to see when music ministry is like on 1,000, it's in excellence and everything like that. And I love to hear a great word, but there's nothing like being in a service where the musicians, the singers, the pastor, like you can tell that they talked, you can tell that they prayed together. You can tell that there is some kind of cohesiveness between all of those parts. And music ministry goes on throughout the whole service. So pastor, you can stay in your office, but music ministry is also with the band standing behind you when you're preaching. That's music ministry as well. And then the song we sing at altar call is music ministry. So yeah, so you ain't getting away from that. So you might as well go ahead and make that thing good.
So how long have you been in music ministry?
Man, you know, my whole life almost, you know what I'm saying? It's weird, but I haven't always been a minister of music, but I've always been in music ministry. You know what I'm saying? So when I was younger, they said, like when I was like 3 or 4, I was in a youth choir and we was in rehearsal and people were singing wrong notes. And I'm like singing the right harmony for them. They're like, I'm teaching the sopranos, you know, at 6 years old, like this your note. It just happened. You know what I'm saying? And when they saw that, they started to use me and my brother, like in those positions. And then of course, when we got older, when I was 14, I was directing the adult choir. So my aunts and my mama, I'm like, no, that's the wrong note. Like, you know. So it's always been in me and I've always been doing it. But the capacity that I'm at now, like probably the last 20 years, I know that seems like a long time because we young, but
right. Yeah.
Long time.
So where did you develop that passion for music ministry? You said you started at a young age, it's just always been in you.
Always, man. Half of my family is musical. I love you. Love you, uncles and aunts. That's not, but most of my family is musical. And my uncle was the keyboard player and the minister of music. And my grandmother sung and my aunts directed. You know, like it was just music all around me. And so in addition to my natural gift coming out, like I was seeing it and I was around it all the time. Like, so I grew up not wanting to be my aunt, but like watching her direct and like taking notes, you know what I'm saying? How to direct the choir and stuff like that.
So how did you hone your craft as, you know, that choir director?
That's a good question. You know, practice. I never expected, like when I was growing up, I wasn't like, yo, I want to be an artist. Like that was never in my mind. Like I'm trying to travel the world. That was not Sam. Like I just was happy at my church directing. Like I was so happy and I just wanted like it to be great. So I was like, ever since I was, even when I was younger though, I was like trying to put on a good show in church, you know what I'm saying? Trying to give y'all something y'all ain't never seen and about to really, you know, crush y'all. So that was my mind, but it was only for church. Like I wasn't thinking like, I'm about to take this on the road. Like that wasn't me.
Right.
So I feel like just me being faithful to my church really was what made me what I am today. Like that's just.
Who are some of your influences?
Man, I love everybody, you know what I'm saying? Kirk Carr for the drama, you know what I'm saying? Drama comes from Kirk Carr and Kirk Franklin for the, you know, the vocals and the writing. Jonathan Nelson, Donnie McClurkin. I mean, let me think of who else. Ricky Dillard, of course, you know what I'm saying? Like the Squall came, you know. When I want to hear a Squall, I go to Ricky Dillard and New G. But I also am influenced by a lot of independent artists. I want to give a shout out to all the independent choir directors and artists. Right. I listen to them the most. You know what I'm saying? Like, no shade, but Tasha Cobb and all of them, they got enough fans. So I'd be like, let me pay attention to the independents and see, because there's a lot of great talent and a lot of great music and all that stuff in the independent artists. And a lot of times we just don't know about them. And I really try to listen to that, to them rather. And I play it in my car, and anybody come around me, you're going to hear some independent music. And a lot of times they'd be like, oh my God, whose song is that? Like, yeah, that's from Joe Smo and Kentucky. You ain't heard of them, but this joint killing, ain't it? So I just listen to everybody, and I feel like everybody makes me better. I pick up something from everybody I listen to.
Wow. So, you know, as a choir director, when was the, I was bringing all these ministers of music on, but I said, I got to get my brother on here. I never know if you have been, I know you directed some choirs and you've been in some fellowships over some choirs, but have you had the role of minister of music?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. So my resume, I've been in many positions, salaried as a minister of music. So, you know, one of my toughest jobs was when I was hired at a church, and the church was a older church, and their pastor had retired or something like that. And then my friend got hired or voted in as the new pastor, but he had a church of young people, and they had to come together. And ta-da, he wants to hire me, right? And so I had the task of trying to merge these two churches musically and make sure that, you know, like, we're going, the whole thing was a transition, you know what I'm saying? Trying to merge these two churches that were pretty much the opposite of each other. One church was wearing doilies and black and white on Sunday, and another church was wearing t-shirt and jeans singing CCM music. You know what I'm saying? Literally was two totally different churches. But luckily I had a great time there, and we had a great music ministry. But it's all by the grace of God. But yeah, I love being a minister of music, and now, like, it's more like director of worship. You know, we changed the title. So I was over the dancers, I was over the drama ministry, like all of that was under worship, the minister of worship or whatever. Yeah. So yeah, I've had many different jobs in that title and different titles.
Yeah. See, I didn't know you was over the dance. So you were like,
I was over the dance. Do it again.
Yeah. Now, when you talk about merging, and I think that is one of the challenges of today, because, you know, everybody wants to sing Maverick City now. So how do you kind of merge? Hey, some people want to hear the hymns. Some people want to hear, you know, Pastor Mike. People want to hear CCM. Like, how difficult of a task is that?
It wasn't difficult for me because I am a eclectic person already. So I like it all. So it ain't like when I came in, I was all the way only choir music or anything like that. So I was already eclectic. So no problem with me. The only thing I tried to do was try to make some kind of organization to it, because we can't have, you know, Shirley Caesar every Sunday, but we also can't have Maverick City. Well, they weren't out back then. But anyway, we can't have CCM every Sunday. Every song can be, you know, Wade in the Water, whatever. So I made, like, first Sunday was like the more traditional. So even praise and worship, like, y'all need to do something traditional. Y'all need to, you know, sing a hymn, sing a congregational song. It can be even an updated version of a congregational song, but you know, something that, you know, feels like old church or reminds us of that, whatever that the saints can get with. So I did that. And then, you know, of course we had like a fourth Sunday was like, I forgot, youth Sunday, something like that, whatever. Anyway, I just tried to make a thing to make sure that during the month we made sure that we hit all of those things. And I stayed on the praise and worship leaders about their song selection. They had to get their songs approved by me. Like, no, that's not gonna work. No.
Oh, wow. See?
Every week, dog, every week.
So we living in a time where we have the praise team over here, they pick their song. Then we got the choir director over here, they pick their songs. But you had the task of saying, you know what? This ain't going to
And if a song ain't work, you know, I'm getting the call. And, bro, what was that, dog? Why you let them sing that song? Like, yeah, so it was all on me.
So how important is that relationship between that minister of music and musician?
And a musician, oh man, you know, I brought my little bro in at this job. I had my little bro, he was young, he was gifted, but he was moldable. And I thought it was the perfect thing for that church. It worked out so well. It is so important, like, because we can't get in a place where it's like the band is like this you know, it's all part of the music ministry. No, like we don't just send them the music and they play it. No. Me and the MD, you know, that was his title, the MD.
Right.
We pretty much did everything together. We planned things together. Like, as I'm thinking myself, I'm involving him. I'm not just sending him the list. You know what I'm saying? Like, bro, this is my vision for the Christmas cantata, you know, whatever. You know, any songs that you think going to work, whatever. You know what I'm saying? That kind of thing. And I think that it helped make that hard task of merging those generations in those churches, as well as, you know, us both being new to this situation, like, it made it work really well.
So that collaboration is important.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. And you can do it without it, but
that might not work.
It ain't gonna be. Yeah.
And so I'm sure that musician appreciated, like, hey, what do you think? Because sometimes we'd be like, this is it. Here go the songs, learn them.
Yeah.
So it's like.
I really didn't want it to be like that. And especially since I had so many responsibilities, you know what I'm saying? Like, it can't all be from Sam's, you know what I'm saying? Like, this musician may have heard songs I ain't heard before. Maybe they have a, you know, musically they can see a way to get through songs better than I can or whatever, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
We need each other.
Now, you know, I know you're an artist, but how is that I want to say that difference between working with singers that, hey, they can sing, we know they're going to know their part, and you're in church, and they're basically volunteers, as my bishop say. We can't fire them. They volunteers. Right. This might not even be the ministry for them.
Oh, God. Bro.
How was that?
Bro, when I got hired at this church, I'm sorry I keep talking about this church, but when I got hired at this church, my brother texted me and was like, yo, you got to do something with that praise team. The praise team had 20 people. I'm not even joking. Had 20 people. Now, you know, I'm not going to let the praise team have 20 people. My bro already said, I got to do something. So I'm like, all right. So I had evaluations, dog. One by one, y'all had to come downstairs. I'm sitting at the piano, like, repeat after me. Like, let me sing the middle note, blah, blah. People that fail, I'm so sorry. You're not going to be the praise team. But I really would love you to be a part of the choir. People left the church, dog. People got pissed at me. Some people got pissed and stayed. And some left, and like left. I was just doing my job, you know what I'm saying? I don't know, but that praise team choir thing, that definitely is something I'm not gonna back down on. That's something that's very important. But artist church, you know what I'm saying? Like, my choir is, I'm very blessed, you know what I'm saying? They know their stuff and they know not to play with me. But church, Sam, I understand they're volunteers. I'm pretty much the same person, for real. But you know what I'm saying? Of course, we have like female basses, and you'd be like, what note are you singing? And all that stuff. Like, you go through all of that. But I really have grace for people like that. I love church choirs. I love being able to develop people. And I think that it speaks more of a director or a leader to be able to take something that's kind of like rough. And then, you know, 2 years later, you're like, oh, that choir really killing, you know?
Right.
Like, that makes me feel more proud than just being able to stand in front of singers that are already trained and are amazing. I love that. But being able to develop and train people like that is really the heart of a director. And so I love that. It is very challenging, and sometimes, as you pointed out, and sometimes you have to like turn that mic off, and you know, all of that. We gotta do all that, and I'm sure people experienced that during the pandemic or whatever. Like, turn that mic off, or whatever. But because we don't want to hurt your feelings, and we don't want you know,
right.
You are volunteers, and we appreciate you, but we also got to keep this audience. Praise God.
Right.
Yeah. So, but yeah, I love both sides of it, bro.
You brought up those evaluations. I remember I was singing for Trini Massey in the community choir. And, you know, the community choir, pretty much, they're the singers of the singers. But, you know, some stragglers come in.
Yes, sir.
And slip on in. And so, you know, some people you had, they ain't want to learn their part. Some people was miming.
Okay.
Because, you know, they wanted to travel with the choir.
Yes, sir.
So every now and then, Trini will be like, okay, evaluations, tenor, soprano.
Yes, sir, Trini.
Those was the scariest moments, because people were like, oh, no, evaluations. And then we had the traveling choir.
All right, see? Yes, sir.
And that's when we had to have evaluations. And so people were like, how'd you make it? And it was just like, it was a... So to imagine you doing evaluations...
Man, it
was a church choir.
That church, dog. It shook that church, dog. Like, it was like in the first month of me getting hired, too. Like, oh. But I had to do it, man. I had to do it.
Yeah. And then then I also remember, because I come from, like, I'm traditional Baptist. We ain't have, praise and worship wasn't out back then. We had devotions. The deacons,
yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Leading the devotions. And so I went to this, like, non-denominational church.
Mm-hmm.
And they had auditions.
Okay.
And it was, I was like, ooh, I don't know if I'm gonna make it.
Did you make it, brother?
I made it.
All right.
I made it. And let y'all know, I made the traveling choir for the cause too. Now,
let's go.
I still got a little bit in me.
You're like a first tenor, Nick. Yeah.
Now, define artist. What's your definition of an artist?
You know, contrary to popular belief, an artist is not someone who records. Everybody has the ability to record. I'm so sorry. Yeah, you may have recorded a song. You may have released it. Does not make you an artist, unfortunately.
Say that again, brother. Say that again.
Just because you record or have released a song does not make you an artist. I really, really love you, but you're not an artist. An artist to me, man, like, I feel like there has to be another level of excellence. And also, like, the first part of that word is art. There has to be some kind of, like, artistic, creative, like, something that makes you, like, a little different, a little, like, a little special. You know what I'm saying? Like, it ain't just a song. You know what I'm saying? Like, what about you is, like, you in a crowd of people. You know what I'm saying? If you go to American Idol auditions, dog, you're going to get dogged. But you want us, because we're in church, to just be like, kumbaya, no, your song sucks. You're dry. Like, let's try it again. Stay in your church praise team, your choir. I'm sure you're anointed, but not to be an artist. You have to sell records.
Right.
You got to sell records against all the 200 million people that want to release a song. You got to make a chart. Like, what? No. It got to be more than just I like to sing. Like, it ain't that. It ain't that, and it ain't that I went to the studio. It has to be something very, very special about you, and not just, like, you know what? It's a lot of not really talented people who are really, really committed to this. They're really committed. They put the money in it. They put the time in it. They go to all the conferences. They do all the showcases, and you're still not an artist, because it's really not about how much, unfortunately, it's not about how much effort you put into it. It's really about, like, you're, like, born unique or something, like, special in you, or it's not. You know what I'm saying? And maybe your special thing is, like, you on a computer, or maybe your special thing is, like, you know, you making clothes, but it ain't music for everybody. It's not music. Everybody loves music, but it's not music for everybody, like, to be an artist. You know what I'm saying? You got to stand against some really, really talented and supported people. And it's not as easy as people think now, like, since it's so accessible now.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So you mean to tell me, just because I did a live recording?
Baby, and that's even put on history as one of the most expensive things you've ever done. But other than that, we don't remember.
Right.
Don't remember. I don't.
You know,
I don't
then,
know from that record, baby. I don't know.
We have these. We have, and this is creative conversation, so I'm gonna say what I want to say. We have these flyers where it'll be like national recording artists or recording artists.
I hate them things. I hate it. I hate it because my friends that are actually national recording artists don't put that on their flyers. I don't understand.
Right.
Because if I go one state over and ask somebody about you, they don't know you. So you can't be national. Like, and I also hate this highly anticipated single. This is your first single. How is that highly anticipated? Who anticipated it?
Oh, yeah. I remember I was working with a singer. And I asked, you know, Uncle Bill.
Yes.
I went to Uncle Bill for help. And he was like, this person had the same name as, you know, somebody, famous artist.
Okay.
You know who it is, but I don't want to. If you do mind, you know. And they were like, well, there's already somebody's name now, so what you mean? And then he was like, and it was like you said, the most anticipated single of the year. He's like, this is his first single. We don't know him.
Yes,
shout
sir.
Out to Uncle Bill.
Uncle
he
Bill.
Was real. He was like, listen, you need to do this, that, and that, because this ain't
Uncle Bill keeps it real. Okay.
And people will be like, yeah, the most critically acclaimed.
And they're like, and the critics are like, your mother and your best friend, like, no.
Right.
No, bro.
So I think, you know, when you've been around the best, like, I've been around you, I've been around Trini. So not a lot, I'm going to be honest, not a lot impresses me, I want to say. Like, and people really be like, woo!
And the great thing, the thing about it is, like, we're not saying that and saying, like, y'all, that people need to do it to impress people.
Right.
When it, like, when it's just on someone, like, it just happens. You know what I'm saying? Like, you can just, you know when somebody's special. You know what I'm saying? Like, it ain't another Trini Massey. Like, it ain't. It's not another Travis Malloy. There is one, you know what I'm saying? Like,
right.
And it's just what it is. Like.
And also, just because you can get your project on iTunes, that don't.
Maybe.
Is that, maybe I'm wrong. If you get it on iTunes, that make you an artist or
no? No, it does not. At this point, iTunes is on your birth certificate. Like, you can just, anybody in the world, like, you can sign up for TuneCore, Songcast, you can sign up for anything, and if you pay your little $69.99, you can get on iTunes.
Or back in the day, CD Baby.
Yes, CD Baby. Listen. It used to be like a feat to get on iTunes. Like, what? You on iTunes? That's when I came out back then, when I was like, oh, like, it's 10 of us on iTunes, you know, outside of the main people. Now,
everybody's on there.
Everybody.
Yeah, I haven't been with the artist in a minute. I remember when I was with Tia Cherie, and we had to go through all these hoops. Yeah. Hey, like you said, now it's like almost free.
Yes, sir. Included, you know, just in your gym membership or whatever.
There's another one.
Yeah.
If you are internet radio, does that mean you're an artist?
Man. Listen, just because y'all have a Twitter page. Listen, I love all the internet radio stations and I appreciate them playing my music. But, like, the internet radio stations is like in somebody's basement or something, or, and it's no shade, but I'm saying, like, and there is a chart for internet radio stations. So you can be like, I have some friends that are on the top of the charts on internet radio. Unfortunately, if you go to that other chart, the terrestrial radio, you probably won't see those same people. And that's fine. Like, if you make that internet radio and you like rule that, then that's fine. I mean, that's no shade to that. Like, do your job. That's great. However, you cannot be upset when you go to a big weekend, like a Stellar Weekend or one of those events where there's like national artists, and you say, hey, I'm a top three, you know, internet radio station, and they've never heard of you, never seen you, never heard your song. They're two different worlds. And so it's no shade, but if you're a real artist that has something special and you're doing the right things, then you should be on, like, that internet radio station success should then spill over into that terrestrial radio success. And people should be able to see you in both markets.
So how do you being an artist? Well, I'm gonna ask this. When did you know you were an artist?
Man, I'm still finding out. Like, I'm gonna be like, me? Like, you throwing me? Like, I'm just saying, man. But I noticed that when I made my first record a long time ago, I made my first record 2007, so 15 years ago. And people, like, and this can happen. I'm not saying that, but people calling me, saying, like, dog, that song, blah, 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 like, that thing got me through my mother's death, like, or you know, my church is singing a song on Sunday. I'm like, huh? Like, okay, cool. First record, I'm like, maybe it's just my friends being nice. You know what I'm saying? Then, you know, I started, you know, traveling and singing and whatever. And then later, when I started LA, like, I think that's when it really sunk in, like, going to different cities. And I don't know these people, but, like, at Cheddar's or some restaurant, they're like, you Sam Roberts? And I'm like, me? Like, you know me? Like, yeah, I got your record. I got, like, wait, me? Like, that's crazy. So it started to be like, wait. People, like, actually know me. Like, they're listening to my music and they're paying attention, and it's helping people and it's blessing people. So I think at that point I was like, okay, maybe I been doing this thing right. But again, it really was never my intention to be like a star or an artist or whatever like that. It just kind of happened through being consistent.
Wow. And so, someone who is an artist, how do you take that artist hat off when you're with your church? Or like, how do you navigate those spaces?
Yeah, man, that's a good question. I think that part of my hat is always on because I just have my general mindset is excellence. So excellence at church or excellence as an artist is excellence. You know what I'm saying? So they get a part of that, of artist Sam Roberts when I work at a church or I'm serving at a church. But it's definitely from a different perspective. Again, back to like a heart to develop. That's what it's excellence or a goal of excellence. And as an artist, it's more like a standard of excellence. Like you got to come in the door excellent for me as an artist. But Sam at the church, like I'm trying to help you become excellent and trying to teach you how important excellence is. So it's a mix of both.
And how at the church, what do you determine song selection wise? Like how do you determine your song selection?
You know what I love in the beginning of my tenure at the church that was merging, the pastor was telling me his sermon topics or his series or whatever, and I could really like direct the songs so that it will lead up to his message. I love that. I love something themed. I love something cohesive. Now he stopped doing it at some point. And so at that point, I'm like, well, let's just get something that's going to be good. You know, that's going to be a story in. And then whatever he preached, you preach. But and so then where the cohesiveness had to come in was like during the altar call or after he done stirred the church up. And now we're doing like a praise break chant or something like that, whatever. Yeah. But you know what I'm saying? Knowing the house, knowing where I'm trying to, not only just where they are, but where I'm trying to take them, like where we're trying to take them in worship, that helped me approve or not approve the song and stuff like that. But and even the choir songs, like I picked some choiry songs. Like I wanted the choir to be the choir, and I let the praise team be the little praise team. But when that choir, yeah, and we got like 30 deep. I was excited. Like, y'all, I'm gonna teach you how to scream. Yeah, right. So yeah.
So is there still room for the choir in the church?
There's always
these ensembles and praise teams now.
Always room for the choir. And listen, I said this on another live. Even if your praise team, because this is what's happening now, even if your praise team is 9 deep and y'all screaming in the mics and singing choir music, I'm happy with that. Hey. I think that we're more concerned about choir music than the actual institution or organism of the choir. Like, you know, if your church don't have a 30 person ministry or whatever, like choir, if it's a 12 person praise team and y'all gonna sing Ricky Diller or whatever, Milton Brunson, I'm happy. You know, I think that the choir community will be happy. It's not really, now we do want you to have a choir if you can, but if you don't have a choir and you're gonna keep singing choir music, because I feel like that's is what we have to be loyal to and make sure that that does not leave the church, because some churches literally don't have enough singers to have a choir. So we can't like press about that. But the music, the choir music that really, we ain't had no praise teams going up. So the whole service was choir music, you know what I'm saying? Him. We just don't wanna lose that. We don't wanna lose that. That is a part of the authentic DNA of church.
That's a good answer. Why do you think in some places they want to try to get rid of the choir or the choir sound? What is your,
you know,
is it just the trends we see, the fads?
Yes, dog. Yes. It's monkey see, monkey do, and it's pissing. Ooh, I mean, it's making me mad. It's making me very sad. That's all it is. Like whatever you see starting to go big on Facebook or IG or YouTube is what you're about to start seeing in church. And my bro, Vashawn Mitchell, said this to me a couple months ago. Like, it used to be that the church was gospel music club. You know what I'm saying? Like, in the world, the music is pushed in the club. And it used to be that in church, we would hear songs that would make us be like, let's go buy this record. Let's go find out who sings this. And now it's like the internet is the club. You know what I'm saying? We're following what the internet does. And it's really unfortunate. Any church I'm working at, we ain't following the internet. We follow what God's doing and whatever. But that's all it is. Y'all, because because the media is whitewashed. Now y'all want y'all churches whitewashed, and y'all want to wear jeans and like, so y'all wearing jeans and t-shirts and hats only so y'all can just still speak in tongues and follow. I'm confused. It's the same church. Like, y'all don't have the same church. And because y'all wearing jeans and t-shirts, now y'all like, y'all up to date and God is doing a new thing and y'all are free. Like, no, you're not free, because you're still ending up on the ground. Your pastor's still hooping. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's all the same, thing. You're still having the same exact service. It's very annoying.
Like, I know, man, I do know, like, back in the day when GA came out, all the
That Ty was our dog. I follow Ty around this country. Me and my friends, we went to everything. Ty had a ski weekend at the Poconos. We went to everything, dog. We was Ty tripping out. Ty was ministering to us like never before. but you know what I'm saying? Like, and of course we tried to take that back to church. You know what I'm saying? We had a little short ties and do
right,
all that.
Right, right.
But I mean, for what?
Pastor anyway. Was like, wait a minute. You want to put these robes on?
Right.
Now, one thing my bishop was saying, and that might be here, I don't know if it's around the country, he was saying that you don't see a lot of youth choirs anymore.
That's true. But you know what? I totally agree. And I was thinking about that the other day, actually. I was like, Lord, I hope there's some youth choirs left, because that honestly, just like you said, the youth is like the future of the church. Like, the youth choir is the future of the music ministry. Like, to be able to see a healthy youth ministry or youth choir or youth praise team, like, that shows that music ministry is going to be able to keep going. But honestly, the funny thing is a lot of the youth are on the main praise team now, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I mean, it's kind of like I don't know, but you definitely see like a younger majority of the leaders,
yeah,
in the music ministry are younger or young adults. So,
and then you're like, back in the day when you were on the youth choir, some people was forced to be.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, dog.
But what Nikki Thorpe was saying last week, she was like, but the choir is where people like get their development. Like,
that's
the choir is where people develop. Like,
yes,
just like kind of like the usher board. Now people, hey, you want to do ministry? Go to the usher board. And she was saying like, that's how the choir is. The choir was back in the day. Anybody was on that. The football player that
you
know.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dog, I swear by the choir because because of that. Like, it is a training place. It's a development place. And right. Because I'm old enough, I was in the choir with 400 young people at convocation. And, you know, I know half of them in the beginning didn't want to do it. But right. You know what I'm saying? By the time we're 14, we know what suit you wearing to come. You know, now we're trying to make sure our suits look fly. We're trying to make it to the front row. And then they end up, you know, they're basketball players by day or whatever. You know what I'm saying? Like you were saying. And you would never expect them to be in a choir or whatever. But we all can look back and say part of our training in life was from being in a choir. And even with my LA, like my choir, I try to explain to them, because I had some like solo-y singers, I had some CCME singers in my choir, and they're like, I'm not a choir singer. And I'm like, I'm trying to explain to you something. I'm doing this because I'm asking you to be in this choir, or I'm inviting you because this is a place of development for you.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm not saying that you about to come here and now you about to have, you know, the squall of life. But if you stick around, by the time you leave, bro, you're gonna be something better. Like, it's gonna be a blessing to you being a part of a choir. Like, it teaches you discipline. It teaches you like stuff that just, you know what I'm saying? Like, you cannot really buy. And, right. And it's kind of like a cheat code, you know, for real. Especially if you want to be an artist, to me, being in a choir or serving at a church, like, that is the development. That's like training that you cannot pay for. Like, going to an artist development, which really does not even exist anymore right now. You go serve at a church or sit in that tennis section or outdoor section, and you wear black and white when they say wear it, and you go by that masters, whatever the rules are, and you follow those rules. By the time you get to something big, you're gonna be like, oh, it's easy, because I was in the choir. Like, what?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I am a super fan of the choir, not just because of like the cliche, like I'm a choir guy, but because I really believe that it really helps develop people, not just musically. Like, it's great.
Mm-hmm. So have you, like, do you have people in LA, they might not be the best singer,
I don't really. I try not to have that in LA. You know what I'm saying? Like, everybody's pretty much like handpicked or whatever.
Right.
But I mean, are some differently skilled than others? Yes. Like, right. Like I said, I have some really, really like lead singer people. Some people that can sing really groupy, and I have some people that you're just an amazing flat-footed alto that just can holler. You know what I'm saying? Now, if we're going to sing background for Jonathan, that's what I bring you. Maybe not, but it ain't because you're terrible. It's just because that's not like something that you've mastered yet. You know what I'm saying? And so right. That's really my thing with LA. It's like, I want to bring the pretty singers, the heavy singers, the soloist singers, and I want to teach y'all all how to do the other thing. And so when you leave, you won't just be one-sided. You can, you know, if somebody calls you to do this, you can go do that. Even though it may not be like your thing, you can do it. You know what I'm saying?
So you've been doing this for a minute.
Has
there ever been a time where you're like, yo, I can't do this no
more? Oh, like, every other month. I'll be like, yeah, I'm out of this. I'm too old for this. I can't do this. You know, because people are something, dog. And it just really blows my mind. People will commit to something or join something out of their own will and then act like something like some kind of burden or something like, wait. I didn't even make you do this. You said you wanted to do this. And now all I'm saying is we got rehearsal on Thursday. And you now, no? Okay, great. Yeah.
Wow, it is. I remember, I go back to my Trudy Massey days. He did not play. I remember one time we was on an engagement, and I don't want to put nobody out there.
Okay.
But he fired the whole band.
Oh, okay. I like that kind of carrying on. Listen.
And one of the things he was saying, he was like, you will never be able to say that I need you. Because I can get another. Like, you had, like, some of his best, I'm putting people's business out there, Jesus. Some of the best, like, soprano, you know, some of the best soloists.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, in the community choirs, we got dues we got to pay. Some of those people hadn't paid no dues, but they was like, I know I'm going to be on this because I'm the...
Listen.
And so it's like, How do you discipline those people that they know, like, he need me, for a better word? Like, how do you discipline? Like, what is the discipline process?
This is such an on-time word. I'm doing this right now, and I hope they watch it. This is my discipline, because I'm a Trini Massey kind of dude. I'm a Charles Butler kind of guy. That's my brother. That's my best friend. This is my discipline to you. I don't include you. That's it. I listen. I don't have to yell at you. I'm not gonna send you no angry email. We're gonna end up on a stage. We're about to do a live recording, and you're not invited. I have 5 million friends that can sing. 5 million friends that can sing. I'm gonna be okay. And that is the ultimate sting. You know what I'm saying? Like, that stings more than, you know, embarrassing them in a rehearsal. You know, they get over that. But you about to see us. We about to keep going on this tour. Yeah, we about to. Yeah, keep going. That's all you got to do. Keep going.
And one of the things I had to remember in my younger times, I would be in the church choir, like, well, get out there. And I had to realize...
Yeah.
This is volunteer, but
yeah,
like you said, where we come from, it's like, okay,
we'll get
another one next.
Yeah.
In the church choir. And then, like you said earlier, but that promotes discipline. Sometimes, like, one of the rules, and I had brought to our music ministries and for the cause, you got to have your tape recorder.
Okay.
So even the community choir, the professional community choir, I remember one time Trini was like, y'all got your tape recorders? Put them up. And so he did that. Tape recorder. He was like, oh, okay, I'll see you next week.
All right. See? It's like, because people be doing it. Some of them, I'm not saying, I know some people, some of my singers, like, genuinely like for God or something like that. Like it wasn't like an intentionally, right. Sometimes, a lot of times with us, you know, us kind of people,
right?
We would do it like, they ain't about to kick me out. Like, okay, a tape record. I don't want a tape recorder. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's like a try me kind of thing.
Right.
And they get their time. Sometimes they get right. They get right what they wanted sometimes. And they need that. Cause they need, you know what I'm saying? That person probably had that tape recorder next week. Yeah.
Wow.
But you know, one time at my church, at one of my churches that I was at, I'm very, very big on attire. Very, very big. Like anything I say pretty much, you better do it. But
right.
So I think it was like a Christmas thing. We had, I think it was supposed to be like gold. They could wear like green, gold, or red skirt, something like that, right? And your skirts always, dresses or skirts for girls always have to be knee length or below. Always have to have sleeve, some kind of sleeve on.
Right.
No, whatever. That's just me. So
that's me too.
The choir is like lining up on the side in the hallway, like on the side, about to walk in up on the stage. And I'm going down the line, looking at everybody's outfits, you know, like just going down the line, like, okay, thank you, okay, outfits, whatever. And I discover a young lady who, a talented young lady, she can sing. And her skirt was high. And it was like a printed skirt or something like that. And I was just like, yeah, that's not. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can't let that pass. Everybody was looking like, I said, you can have a seat and, you know, in the party. Like, and people was really like, oh my God. Like, no. Don't play with me. Like, it's because if I let that go, then Sister So-and-so gonna think she can do it. No. Like, you gotta, unfortunately, you gotta prove to people that you're serious. Like, yeah, I'm serious. Like, this is really a rule. I'm not joking.
Right.
You know, they feared me from that moment. Like, oh yeah, let me Sam, is this send me pictures? Is this okay? Yeah, yeah.
Right, right.
Okay. Yeah.
And there were times, because sometimes, now Trini was nice in this area. Sometimes people, they would have the wrong outfit on, they would be messed up. So the next engagement, he'd be like, yeah, this is the engagement. He said, but next Monday, I need y'all to bring y'all outfits.
Okay. That's old school for real. Show
and
me.
He'll be like, oh yeah, that's good, that's good. He was like, you try.
That's only Trinity.
But this is like, and so like, I've been in church choirs, but I've never seen that discipline before. And I've never sung in the Trinity Church Choir, but they told me, this is how it is with the church choir.
Yeah, man. I mean,
the biggest saying is, this is not your local church ministry.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Excellence.
And so if we, like, I just imagine if we just taught excellence from church.
Yes.
I feel like we're so slothful when it comes to church, but like, if it's our job, well, some people are slothful at the job, but that's another. But it's just like, we do any, like, my pastor say all the time, like, we'll do anything in church. We'll come late. We'll just,
yeah. You know? and the thing that really is funny to me about us as people is we definitely recognize excellence.
We do. Like
that Potter's House, sure, they got it. That Northside, oh man, Trinity's Choir, dog.
Right.
No, they got, you know what I'm saying? Like, you can't beat them.
Right.
Not thinking, like, you know, when you come late to your church, like, that's opposite of what they're doing. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Like that. You love what the product of excellence, but you don't want to like participate in the process of it.
Right.
Like, nah. It don't work like that. Like, wow. Yeah, it's
crazy. Wow. This has been an amazing conversation. I mean, yeah, I just thank you for coming on. I'm not ending it yet. So a lot of people, I got my brother on. I could go different ways in music.
Okay.
A lot of people were upset about the Stellar Awards.
Okay.
They said, you know, it wasn't enough old school. They said it was some, you know, said I couldn't tell if we was in the nightclub or if we was at church.
Yeah, I saw that.
I just want to get the artist's perspective Not so much critiquing the Stellars. Because I know, you know, you got to, you know. I know. Now I'm going to get you in trouble.
My take on it, me and my Detroit best friend had the conversation the other day because he just saw it the other day. My thing is, because I personally don't mind the modern expressions as long as it always leaves that feeling like it has room for the glory, which I feel like the G in gospel stands for glory. Like you can have, you know, Christian hip hop, but like when some of my favorite Christian hip hop artists would perform, like I still felt the same Holy Ghost that I felt when, you know, when Don McCurkin said it was presented in a different way, but I always knew that it was like about God. I knew that it was anointed because I felt it, you know, so I appreciated James Fortune's performance. You know what I'm saying? It would maybe have had the trap beat behind it, but like it had room for like ministry in it. I still felt like, okay, this is gospel. This is God. You know what I'm saying? Now, I do agree that we need to have some kind of balance. You know what I'm saying? Like it can't be 98% hip hop gospel. You know what I'm saying? Like, because there is a very large audience. And again, this goes back to what we was talking about that monkey see, monkey do. You know what I'm saying? Like, yes, that's what you see, that it looks like urban hip hop gospel is what people like, but them people sitting at their houses, when we turn on the Stellars, a lot of us want to feel God. Like we want to see something that looks like what we used to see or whatever, in some ways on Sunday morning or whatever, you know what I'm saying? That the Stellar Awards has the responsibility to represent gospel as a whole. And I think that sometimes in our attempt to make sure we don't, you know, miss the new wave, that we sometimes forget or give a smaller space to what is the foundation of our genre. And so I think that we can do a better job with balance, but I think that it was a positive step in the right direction in terms of focusing on presentation. But now we got to figure a way to incorporate and integrate the two. Like it can be, how can we help Shirley Caesar? Like maybe she don't have to worry about the lights and the dancers. We just do that and they accompany her, or we do, you know, we do some kind of thing with the LED wall or whatever while she's doing that, and she can just be Shirley Caesar. You know what I'm saying? So we can make everything on a level playing field, but still make sure we reach all the audiences, and that at the end of the day, it feels like gospel.
Yeah. This is one of the best answers for both sides, because I watched it. I wasn't as offended. But I seen one artist up there singing, and they had, I felt like they had them dancers on every set.
Yes, they did. They did. I was like, okay. When I saw this with Jason Ellis, I'm like, artist,
I'm not going to name his name. You know him. Okay. He was singing the song. He looked uncomfortable with them dancers.
Yeah. I know exactly what you're talking about, bro. Yeah. Yeah. Like, he's like, y'all can use the dancers on everybody? Like, what?
Like,
them joint, they contracted, okay. But
right, they must have contracted them dancers.
Yeah.
Like, every song, worship, tribute, y'all dancing.
Yeah.
They might have got, and it was an ATL, they might have got them from somewhere.
From the
pink. From the
pink.
They was like, I mean, it was a worship song, and they didn't sit
after. Man, I mean, like I said, like we saw the effort to try to make it, you know, whatever, but we cannot.
Before the argument was that we had too many veterans, you know, so it's not, we probably never going to satisfy everybody.
Man, well. They can try, okay.
They can try.
They can try next year.
Oh, man. I appreciate you, brother, for coming on. Before we close out, I just want you to encourage that worship pastor that's trying to do excellence, but they're like, Lord, they get frustrated trying. Just encourage that worship pastor or that, what do we call them? We don't even call them ministers of music. But worship pastor.
Okay,
minister of music.
Man, I have been you. I have been you. And I would say that the best advice I can give you is be consistent. You know what I'm saying? Like, your frustrations. One day you're gonna be frustrated, one day you're gonna be happy, whatever. In spite of all of those waves of your emotions, be consistent as a leader. Let what the people see and what you present always be consistent. Don't back down on what you feel is a standard, and what you feel is the road to excellence because of the way people react to it, because that is very easy, like easy to do. People don't show up for rehearsal when you want to be prompt, and don't stop pushing promptness. Do not stop. Don't stop pushing studying your music or whatever things that you're implementing, because one day it's going to click.
Oh, that was good, brother. That was good. Again, I want to thank Sam Roberts for coming on, my brother. It meant a lot. You know, I have a couple people that are artists or whatever, and the fact that they would just drop what they're doing to come and just be a part of my little bitty show means so, so much. So are you working on anything, brother?
Brother, I have a live recording coming up on November 5th.
That's my birthday.
Oh, man. That's my little brother's birthday, too. And in Maryland, the title of this record is called CCM. And I know it's not for naught though, y'all. I'm not a traitor. I have not.
Yo, I love it.
Thank you, brother. We about to be a choir on that stage. I'm not giving up choir music at all. The record is called CCM. If you want to know what it means, stay tuned. But I'm really excited about this record, and I hope that y'all can make it November 5th.
That's some good marketing, man.
Thank you, brother.
You know, I like a good marketing.
Yes, sir. Got to make the people wonder.
I might have to try to come up.
Brother, it's your birthday.
I know.
Your cake.
I was at the first LA recording. Me and Travis came through.
Yes.
Wow. So be on the lookout. Give them your information, brother. Anything.
Man, y'all can find me on Instagram.
You do workshops?
I do. I love doing workshops. I love doing them. Actually, funny thing, somebody prophesied to me during the pandemic and said, when the pandemic is starting to end, like, you're going to get called for a lot of workshops. Like, a lot of churches are going to bring you in to train their workshops. I'm like, okay, do it, Lord, because I love doing that. That's one of my passions, teaching.
Oh, wow, okay.
I remember doing one, like, coming to one at your church, man, a long time ago at Northside. Like, it was,
oh,
I don't
know. Okay.
It was dope, but yeah, man,
y'all, but we'll talk about that.
Y'all can hit me on IG at just Sam Roberts. You know, Facebook is Sam Roberts. Y'all can find me. And if you want to email me and the choir, we'd love to come to your city to your event. LeviceAssembly@gmail.com.
Wow, thank you again, brother.
Thank you, brother. It was an honor.
Oh man, I gotta have you back on again.
Let's go.
Appreciate you. Appreciate everything you're doing. I just appreciate you being a brother more than a
sir.
You know, artist and all that. When I hit you up, you ain't saying, oh, I'm busy.
I even think twice, man, because you're a great brother, man.
I appreciate you. I appreciate all my brothers. They may be doing big things, but they never, you know, drop. They spare no expense of dropping for the big brother. And so I appreciate you. CCM, everybody.
Yeah.
Be on the lookout. I'm excited. I might have to come up. Bishop, I might not be in service. No.
Please excuse him, Bishop.
Please excuse me.
Let me know, bro.
I will. All so, right. Everybody, thanks for being on Creative Conversations with J.A. I had my brother stop by. I got my other brother next week, Pastor Mark Collier.
Let's go.
That's gonna be good. I've enjoyed this session this month. Like I say all the time, thank you for being on Creative Conversation. Never ever forget to have a creative conversation. Peace out.